Our next panelist is Norman Pollock. He likes to call himself a writer. He calls himself an analyst. But he's also listed here as a naval and intelligence historian. He likes to point out he does not have a degree in history. But on the other hand, I think it's useful to like call himself that. He's written more books of history than books of science have. So it's worthwhile for doing that. His biography says he's an analyst, consultant, and author specializing in naval aviation and science and technology issues. He's consulted on naval-related issues for three U.S. senators, Speaker of the House, the Deputy Counsel to the President, as well as the Director of Los Alamos National Laboratory. He's directed studies for U.S. and foreign shipbuilding and aerospace firms, and been a consultant to the leadership of the Australian, Chinese, and Israeli navies with the U.S. government's knowledge. Mr. Pollock has written or co-authored more than 50 published books and numerous articles on naval aviation technology and intelligence subjects. From 1967 to 1977, he was editor of the United States section of the annual reference to James Fighting Ships, and he left there to become the author and editor of the definitive reference books, Ships and Aircraft of the U.S. Fleet, 9 editions, and Guide to the Soviet Navy, 4 editions. He has lectured on naval, aviation, and intelligence subjects to various defense, naval and private organizations in the U.S., Soviet Union, and Russia, China, et cetera, et cetera. He is also working with Rear Admiral Thomas Brooks and Mr. George Fedorov on a biography of Admiral Leader of the Soviet Union, Sergei Gorshkov, which will be coming out next spring from the Naval Institute Press. And without further ado, Norman Pollock. You want to do it from there?
No.
You want to come up here?
No.
Norman, we've been going through this throughout the development of this symposium. What do you want?
Dave, I'm less of a target down here. Immediately after World War II, almost all Western political leaders and military commanders and the intelligence community believed that when war erupted between the Soviet Union and the West, that there would be a third battle in the Atlantic. This view was reinforced by reports that the Soviets were producing hundreds of so-called whiskey-class torpedo attack submarines. Some U.S. admirals estimated that by 1958, the Soviets could have as many as 2,000 submarines. With far fewer submarines, the Germans had come very close to cutting the Atlantic sea lanes in two world wars. After World War II, the U.S. Navy, like the U.S. Army and the British, used senior German officers and specialists to tell their experience in fighting the Soviets. Naturally, the German officers mirror-imaged their own experience, predicting that there would be a third Battle of the Atlantic. These reports are fascinating reading. This is one of the several reports published. This particular one, and the whole series, is called The Soviet Russians as Opponents at Sea. This volume, volume 2A of the set, just talks about the German appraisal of the Russian submarine force. Again, they mirror imaged what they had tried to do and predicted the Soviets would. So that made a lot of sense to us because almost twice the Germans had severed the Atlantic communications. A CIA analysis of 1971 clearly states that in the first decade after World War II, the primary missions of the Red Submarine Force was to attack the sea lanes, the primary mission. Then for the next decade, the primary role was anti-carrier while retaining the major anti-slot or sea lanes of communications. Indeed, at the time, there were more than 4 Soviet cruise missile submarines available to counter each operational U.S. carrier, with the odds against the carriers getting worse every year, meaning that some cruise missile submarines could be diverted to join the several hundred torpedo attack submarines operating against convoys. But ladies and gentlemen, the Soviets did not plan a third Battle of the Atlantic. While that mission appeared in various official documents and articles in military journals, cutting the Atlantic sea lines was not a primary role for the Red Navy for 3 principal reasons. One, they argued, if the Germans were unable to cut the Atlantic sea lanes in two world wars, what could cause the Soviet admirals to believe that their submarines would be successful? Two, in World War II, the Germans had U-boat bases on the French coast, giving them direct access to the Atlantic shipping lanes. Soviet submarines would have to sail around Norway, a NATO country with underwater sound surveillance systems and airfields, in order to reach the Atlantic shipping lanes. Their submarines would not have the range and the endurance to spend much time in the Atlantic after transiting from the Northern Fleet around Norway, down the Iceland, Greenland, UK gaps into the Atlantic. Third, as the Russians told me, at the start of World War I and World War II, the Allied navies were totally unprepared for an anti-submarine campaign. But almost from the start of the Cold War, the Western navies built up a massive anti-submarine force, installed seafloor acoustic sensors, and conducted convoy escort exercises. The bottom line, the Soviets believed that they could not win a third Battle of the Atlantic. Many CIA papers written after the late 1970s and now available in this series demonstrate for the first 30 plus years of the Cold War, the West had feared a Soviet assault on the Atlantic sea lanes, and our intelligence community got it wrong. Thank you.